Welcome to MEA TV. I'm attorney Lilia Tika, and today we have Saima Khalil with us, who is running for Macomb County Circuit Court Judge. Hello, Saima, how are you?
Hi, thank you for having me here.
Of course, thank you for coming. So tell us a little about your history and your background and how you ended up in law school.
For sure. So I was born and raised in Macomb County, actually grew up in Warren, and I'm a graduate of the Warren Woods Public School System and graduated from Warren Woods Tower in 98. Mm-hmm. I went on to Wayne State University where I did my undergrad studies. I went to U of M Dearborn for my master's, and then I pursued my law degree with a concentration in litigation at Thomas Cooley Law School. Mm-hmm. I don't know how I ended up on a legal career path. I just knew that I wanted to be a lawyer. I come from a traditional Pakistani home. My parents are first generation Pakistani. I'm first generation, but my parents were, they immigrated here. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times people from my community, you know, they advocate for their kids pursuing a career in healthcare and become a doctor or an engineer. Yeah. And for some reason, it wasn't an argument or anything. I just wanted to study law, and that's the path I chose.
How old were you, do you think, that when you chose to actually pursue law or be interested in law?
I just knew I always wanted to go down that route. Like in our household, when we talked about what we were gonna, each one of us was gonna do in college, you know, for the my older siblings were all headed down this path of, you know, healthcare careers and biology and chemistry, and here I was thinking history, political science.
Same here. Yeah, I know. I come from a Chaldean background, first generation Chaldean American, actually. So same here. When people ask me, you know, what made you pursue law, I'm like, well, I don't know. I just wanted to be an attorney. And so, what did you do after you graduated from law school?
So after I graduated, you know, I don't think that the legal community is set up to like guide people in the profession. So I just kind of bounced around and did some private work. I basically had my own private practice, but I didn't have the experience that I needed. And I did a lot of pro bono work. And through that, I got, I sort of built my own little practice. So through my pro bono work, I did work through like MSU's tax law clinic. UDM had a veterans clinic. The Michigan Immigration Rights Center, I took on a pro bono case or two from them. And that's, I slowly started to learn, like, you know, develop my skill set. I did some family law, and I started to work on family law. And eventually, I got a job at Lakeshore Legal Aid. And then I fell in love with it. I always wanted to go to court, and legal aid got me into court morning and afternoon, 5 days a week if I wanted, and I just fell in love with it. I love going to court.
You like litigating a lot?
I absolutely love it. I love the disagreement, and I love like doing the negotiations. I love the interaction with the court. And then, you know, you leave work at work, and then you have your professional relationships with everybody. It's just, I love it.
Absolutely. So tell the community what legal aid is, because I don't think they know much about it.
Oh, for sure.
What did you do there?
For sure. So legal aid is basically an organization that provides free legal services to people who qualify, and they get their funding from the federal government, and I think they get some from like the State Bar of Michigan as well. So through the monies that they have, they hire staff who then provide free legal services to those who qualify. And there's guidelines for it. So for example, and then there's priority. So there's like a, there's funding for seniors. And with seniors, it would be like writing wills and estate planning. I specifically was hired under the Violence Against Women's Act grant. So my caseload initially included families that were experiencing domestic violence, whether it was physical, verbal, financial, whatever it was. I did a lot of work under that grant. Legal aid also provided, and continues to provide, free representation for people experiencing eviction. And those are the actually the senior work, the family work, and the eviction work is primarily what I worked on. And also they did collections work as well.
And then after the legal aid, were you still there, or do you have your own practice now?
Well, in 2020, I actually ran for office my very first time. And legal aid, because of its funding, they have certain restrictions. And I was not permitted under their rules to work there and run in a partisan race. And so I had to pick one or the other, and because I decided to run for office, I resigned and I joined the local race, And because I loved the excitement and the opportunity to address systemic issues through running for office, mm-hmm. I just stayed in private practice, mm-hmm. opened up my own law office, Kalia Law, which is in downtown Mount Clemens.
Okay, that's awesome. And what made you run for judge now?
So what made me run for judge is I like to address systemic issues. Mm-hmm. And in the past several years, my practice and my experience has expanded significantly. So I went from just doing civil type of work mm-hmm. to now doing criminal work and appeals work. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, our systems are funded by taxpayer dollars. That's mm-hmm. just what it is. The entire, you know, the judicial system, our law enforcement, our prosecutor's office, it's all funded mm-hmm. by taxpayers. And I don't think that the general public tends to know what happens in a court system, especially if they don't have any interaction mm-hmm. with it. And so when I was working on cases, there were some cases that I worked on that I thought that were assigned to me, where I thought some of the decision making I thought was I thought it was very extreme. And it's what pushed me to run. One of the cases that I have continuously talked about on my campaign is last year. Like, when I say last year, I literally mean last year, mm-hmm. 2023, one of our local judges sentenced a woman to 93 days in jail for driving on a suspended license. This was someone with no criminal background, aside from the inability to pay off tickets, such as no proof of insurance, such as expired plate, and those types of things can cause a suspension of your driver's license. Mm-hmm. And this woman was an hourly worker mm-hmm. at a local fast food chain and was pregnant with her first child. And unfortunately, the perspective of the court was she had picked up too many of these similar charges. But that statute kind of, you end up getting caught up in a cycle mm-hmm. of if you get one ticket and you can't pay it off, and then you get another one because you're still driving. Most people are still driving to and from work.
Yeah.
They get caught up in that, and then the system can punish you. And unfortunately, she was the recipient of a very harsh punishment, even though she had, you know, she was pregnant. And, you know, we have health issue and safety issues there. And I was successful in getting her out of jail, but that kind of stuff happens.
Yeah.
You know, as far as I'm concerned, it would still be happening on some level because the same judges are always still there.
Yeah. So what would you do as judge? I mean, what would your capabilities be when you become judge? What would you be able to do to make these changes?
So one of the things I have learned to value immensely is experience. So mm-hmm. I've been practicing for 12 years, mm-hmm. and I know pretty well what's going to happen on my case. I kind of see how cases can shake out one way or the other, mm-hmm. and I see things that I don't agree with in terms of when I don't see a court doing like a thorough analysis mm-hmm. or just jumping to conclusion, or this is a policy of our courtroom. I think experience matters tremendously on the bench because it matters to victims to have cases be moved forward mm-hmm. efficiently, and it matters for a defendant's constitutional rights and protection of mm-hmm. those rights that we are properly and efficiently moving cases forward. Mm-hmm. And having courtroom experience, I know I can tell you right now what would cause a case to slow down, and I know what we can do to help move those cases forward mm-hmm. and that requires judges to be engaged with the case.
Absolutely.
And see what's causing a slowdown and what can we do to move it forward. That matters a lot to me, but also mental health is really important to me. Mm-hmm. I say this to people all the time, and I said it to you in the beginning. My background, and I think I heard you say this too, my background is not healthcare.
No.
My background is nothing science. I don't know anything about biology. But do you know that practicing criminal defense taught me about schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, and PTSD? And in 2020, a bipartisan report was issued to examine who was sitting in our jails in Michigan. And that report literally said a third of our people that come through suffer from some kind of mental health issue.
Is that the Pew report? I think I saw something about that.
I don't know. I just know that it was like, if you were to Google bipartisan report on pretrial detention mm-hmm. and incarceration, that's like, that combination of words is like the title.
Yeah.
If you see that, and you see that, I knew it as a statistic, as data, mm-hmm. but when I started practicing criminal defense, mm-hmm. my clients had schizophrenia and bipolar disorder.
Yeah.
And I, unfortunately, we do not we as a society are not investing enough in like long-term care treatment facilities for people that have these disabilities, mm-hmm. and they really do suffer. Mm-hmm. And instead, they're being treated in confinement in a jail, and right. that to me is a huge setback. And I can't imagine if it was like, I mean, these are people's brothers, moms, sisters, mm-hmm. fathers, mm-hmm. and I don't know what I would do if that was my family. I would struggle with that. And I believe that I'm an advocate for them as an attorney, and so I'm a huge advocate for specialty treatment courts, because the goal of a specialty treatment court is to target the underlying issue, mm-hmm. and to get treatment for that. Mm-hmm. And that is the best use of taxpayer dollars when we're addressing people's mental health issue and their care. That Absolutely. Makes the individual safer, and it mm-hmm. makes our community safer, mm-hmm. it makes society safer, Absolutely. It makes families safer.
Absolutely. I mean, a lot of people are incarcerated, and usually, I mean, why do people commit crimes? I mean, in all honesty, most of the time it's because of underlying mental health issues that nobody wants to address. Mm-hmm. So putting them in jails or prisons is not really conducive to anything. And our taxpayer dollars are just going toward mm-hmm. nothing. So I definitely understand where you're coming from. Now, what could you do? I mean, do we have a specialty mental health treatment court in Macomb County?
We do. We certainly do have mm-hmm. mental health treatment courts. Thankfully, we also have a veterans treatment court, mm-hmm. thankfully. And I think that those types of services need to be expanded. Sometimes these courts, because mm-hmm. they're grant funding, they can get to capacity. Mm-hmm. So you might have to look around for shop around for another court that might have these services available. And we need to continue to advocate for that improvement. That's mm-hmm. a judge can. Like judges, mm-hmm. we're not supposed to take sides on issues, mm-hmm. but we can always advocate for improvement to systems.
Absolutely.
And that's a very influential position. Mm-hmm. And so the initiative needs to constantly be taken to talk about, here's the types of cases that mm-hmm. come across our courtroom.
Yeah.
And here is like here's how we can address it. Mm-hmm. And I would go back to like the driving situation, mm-hmm. because if you go to a lot of our district courts, mm-hmm. there's a lot of people that still come through our district courts because their driver's license is suspended, mm-hmm. because of the way the statute is written. Mm-hmm. So people pick up these charges and then they pick it up again because they haven't been able to pay it off. Mm-hmm. They get stuck in this cycle. But you know what Royal Oak did? The Royal Oak, and I don't want to misspeak, but I think what the Royal Oak judge did, he saw that this was a problem in mm-hmm. his court, and it's a fixable problem. Right. So he started talking about it. He's like, hey, mm-hmm. listen, I'm seeing a lot of these types of cases. Mm-hmm. Here's how we can make it better. Mm-hmm. And they have an Operation Drive program, a grant-funded program, mm-hmm. that if someone comes in, we get them on this path mm-hmm. to clear these suspensions.
Oh, wow.
So at the end of it, this person can have when they're done with court, mm-hmm. however many months it is, mm-hmm. they come out with a clean driving record. I have not heard of another court that has that.
Yeah.
But what a wonderful thing to give to
yeah.
the community.
Absolutely. What else would you like to see changed, I guess, within the justice system if you do become judge?
I think that I talked earlier about the pregnant woman that goes to jail.
Mm-hmm.
Sentencing, just like the entire cases, it's individualized.
Mm-hmm.
So I like to see, if I was elected judge, mm-hmm. I really believe in that, because it's about the individual, okay?
Mm-hmm.
It's not about a policy in a courtroom,
right.
okay? You have to look at the individual circumstances that led to this particular conviction, this mm-hmm. individual's situation as it stands, and that's how sentencing comes about.
Mm-hmm.
So thoughtful sentencing, to mm-hmm. me, it's critical. That is the job of the judge. So
mm-hmm.
to quickly get to a conclusion without doing that thoughtful consideration mm-hmm. for sentencing, I don't think that that is justice.
Mm-hmm.
Justice requires hearing out not only victims but also knowing how this defendant or accused got to it. I also believe in what I talked about earlier, the efficient administration of justice. Like sometimes cases take a really long time,
mm-hmm.
and I'm sure that is. We have a very adversarial system,
mm-hmm.
and there are certain things that judges can't get involved with, like how cases are charged,
mm-hmm.
and like the adversarial nature of that,
yeah.
where victims' families and the ones that commit the offense, they're almost never brought together
mm-hmm.
until like a day of sentencing. That's like a whole separate conversation, but I think that needs to be addressed. But on a back to like the bench, like on our bench, we need representation from a broader perspective.
Mm-hmm.
So like historically the path to the bench was through the prosecutor's office, or
mm-hmm.
if someone was like had a corp came from a big firm corporate.
Yeah.
my background is legal aid. Mm-hmm. My background is criminal defense. Mm-hmm. And to truth be told, if you sit in a courtroom, most people that come through our courts, that's the people that I serve. That's who we serve. Mm-hmm. They are your average person that have gotten caught up in the system somehow because mm-hmm. of their indigency or because of their mental health issue. Mm-hmm. And that perspective brings a balance to the bench. So you have that diversity on the bench from a knowledge-based perspective, but also diversity in terms of like community representation. Mm-hmm. And I think that we need that in Macomb. Yeah. Macomb's population as a whole is fundamentally different than what it was 10, 15, 20 years ago. So we need to have that representation. And the bench should be reflecting its community. And I think that that builds the integrity of the mm-hmm. institution, which to me is like a hallmark of our democracy. That's how we resolve disputes, you know. Mm-hmm. I would want people to believe in our system, not think that it belongs to a certain group mm-hmm. of people and others are excluded from it.
Mm-hmm. I have a question. So I know that a lot of trials are being live streamed right now. Do you think that's a beneficial thing for our justice system or the exact opposite?
I am struggling with that. I go back and forth on it. I'll tell you the good of it. Mm-hmm. And the good of it is not to that case. The mm-hmm. good of it is the general public does not know about some of the really difficulties of things that happen in a mm-hmm. courtroom. And pandemic highlighted some of the abusive conduct of our mm-hmm. courts. We've seen that. You just have to Google. I won't name names or courts, but you can Google courts, and there have been certain judges that have made headline news mm-hmm. as recent as 30 days ago or within the last 30 days. Yep. And the general public did not know that information. Right. And I personally am not about anyone should be shamed. But the problem is there are sometimes abuses that are happening mm-hmm. and people are afraid to talk about it.
Yeah.
There was a case out of Wayne County in one of the district courts, I won't even name it, but there was that judge who said to this elderly gentleman who had his son translating for him that this is a civil, I think she said something to the effect of, I would sentence you to jail if I could, but this is a civil infraction. And it was for a property cleanup. And they were, that family and that, you know, the dad was trying to articulate that he had cancer or some health issue and then he had been traveling and he couldn't get to it. Mm-hmm. If that case had not been live streamed, mm-hmm. everyone thinks that this court is this, you know, perfect place and everything is happening and everyone is treated with such deference and respect. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that that's always the case. I wish that it were, mm-hmm. but unfortunately, there's a lot of power that's concentrated in one person and no one knows what's going on mm-hmm. until it hits the front news page. Mm-hmm. And I feel bad that those things happen, but I feel like the public wouldn't like that. Mm-hmm. I do see the challenge of being a victim on a case or witness mm-hmm. and having cases live streamed, because that's being in court for any reason. I think it's the worst day of people's lives.
Yeah.
I think people hate it and I don't blame them. Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't, if that was me, I wouldn't want to be broadcast, but I feel like good things have, we have seen some of the deficiencies in our system. Mm-hmm. And because we have the public, not the establishment, but like the public mm-hmm. sees it, and that's what's gonna cause for improvements to the system.
Yeah, I agree. I was thinking the same thing. I just didn't know, like, you know, what others thought, because mm-hmm. I can definitely see the downsides of it. But I mean, I've seen so much happen. Like I've been watching a lot of trials, and you know, a judge was actually removed from a trial. And I honestly think that it's due to the public. Because I feel like if it was behind closed doors and we didn't know about it, nobody would talk about it and nobody would push this issue. But I believe the judge who actually removed the judge that was on that case said it was for the public, because it didn't look good in front of the public. And that's why they removed the judge and replaced him with somebody else. Mm-hmm. So I truly believe that, hopefully at least, this will actually end up being something positive.
Right.
And hopefully, you know, you're there when it happens. So,
right.
Yeah. Anything else that you would like to discuss, if you know, about your history or about the future that you're looking forward to as judge?
Well, I'm just excited about this race. I think I love the legal profession. I love connecting with voters and telling them about the judicial race. Mm-hmm. I know we talked earlier, and I was telling you there's a lot. The average voter doesn't connect with the judicial race, mm-hmm. and people think, why? Like, mm-hmm. I didn't do anything. Why should I vote? But that's not what it's about. Mm-hmm. This, our judiciary is, to me, I said this, it's a hallmark of our democracy. Mm-hmm. It's reflecting our values. Mm-hmm. So when I give you like the examples of certain cases, that's a reflection of us mm-hmm. as a society. Absolutely. And you should want to be engaged in it. If you care about community safety, treatment, rehabilitation, you need to know who your judge is. Mm-hmm. That decision is being made 15 minutes from where you and I are sitting. How can you exclude yourself from mm-hmm. that? And I want people to be engaged with this system. I want them to know about it. I want them to ask questions. I want them to make an informed decision when it comes to judicial races, just as they would for any other race.
Absolutely. And is there another message that you'd like to make for the community on how they can vote and, you know, anything else that you'd like to tell them?
For sure. So judicial races are down ballot races, and most voters do not make it to the bottom of the ballot. This year is a very important election year for all of us. And so it's very important to make your way all the way down the ballot and flip your ballot over. The judicial race is most likely going to be on the back of the ballot. But just flip your ballot over, make sure you filled out all the sections. I would love to have your support, and if you'd like to learn more about me and my campaign, please feel free to visit my website at simaforjudge.com.
Thank you so much, Ms. Khalil.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody, for watching MEA TV.